हेलो फ्रेंड्स, वेलकम टू ईपीजी पाठशाला. दिस इज अंजू वलिदिगु फ्रॉम फैकल्टी ऑफ लॉ यूनिवर्सिटी ऑफ दिल्ली, फॉर्मरली प्रोफेसर नेशनल लॉ यूनिवर्सिटी दिल्ली. आई एम गोइंग टू टॉक अबाउट पनिशमेंट टू रिस्टोरेटिव जस्टिस, फ्रॉम डिसइंटीग्रेशन टू रीइंटीग्रेटिव शेमिंग एज एन एस्पेक्ट ऑफ रिस्टोरेटिव जस्टिस एज एन ऑल्टरनेटिव टू पनिशमेंट. The idea of punishment has always been intrinsically associated with the notion of crime in any criminal justice system, be that adversarial or inquisitorial punishment. Punishment is infliction of an evil or penalty by the state on the wrongdoer, primarily as a retributive measure to ensure law and order, coupled with assuaging the grievances of the victim and the society. Crime and punishment have always been understood as cause-effect sequence, highlighting the underlying assumption that every crime, being a voluntary and deliberate conduct, has to be met with retribution. It's the contribution of Bentham and Beccaria as pioneers of classical school of criminology that identifies crime, every human being, as a free-willed individual driven by hedonistic instincts of pleasure and pain. Hence, every crime necessarily has to be met with a punishment that is deterrent as well as proportional to the severity of crime. Why do we punish? Analyzing the proposal of punishment in the traditional criminal justice administration, one can easily understand that the punishment is used as a tool in shaming the wrongdoer publicly under the hope that the very threat of being shamed would work as a deterrent. The fear of humiliation or embarrassment restrains people from indulging in repetition of their wrongful conduct and also thereby creating an example for others. Shame is a powerful and effective tool for teaching social lessons and altering human behavior. A deeper analysis reveals that corporal punishment results in increasing the antagonizing feelings and increases the conflict between the parties, thereby resulting in disintegrating the relational balance, not only between the offender and the victim, but also impacts the cohesiveness of the society to a great extent. Punishment as a means of regulating human behavior through shaming has two very distinct elements. Beyond the destructive element of shaming that entails into broken relationships, lowering self-esteem, fear of disconnection, shaming can be used as a constructive measure too, to build relationships through restorative practices too. Restorative justice focuses on the reparation of harm done by the wrongdoer and restoring the balance of relations in any given society. According to John Braithwaite, the chief proponent of modern restorative justice approach, restorative justice is all about restoring offenders, restoring victims, and restoring societies, in contradistinction to traditional criminal justice administration that focuses on punishing the criminal by way of retribution coupled with deterrence. He observes that those societies that reintegrate rather than stigmatize and alienate wrongdoers have the lowest crime rates. The benefits of shaming as a restorative practice can be also helpful in addressing the issues of overcrowding in prisons and budgetary constraints. The objective of this lecture is basically to critically analyze, evaluate, examine, and juxtapose the ideological, jurisprudential, philosophical notions of retributive punishment justice on the one hand and restorative justice on the other hand, to compare and contrast between retributive criminal justice system and a restorative criminal justice system. Show how meritorious the restorative practices are over retributive justice, and then proffer suggestions on the ways out of retributive punishment to restorative justice and from disintegration to reintegrative shaming. The aim of a restorative justice is to restore relationships by repairing the harm between offenders, the victims, and the offenders and the community at large, resulting from crime, and thus tries to understand and address the circumstances which contributed to the causation of crime. To hold offenders accountable by giving them the opportunity to take responsibility for the harm they caused and the chance to take action towards repairing that harm and restoring their place within the community. To make room for personal involvement of the parties, that is the offender, the victim, their family members and the community, and to attend fully to the victim's material, financial, emotional and social needs. To prevent recidivism by integrating offenders into the community. As far as brief historical background goes, restorative justice has been an integral part of all indigenous human civilizations, be that Indian Hindu traditions from 600 to 2000 BC, ancient Buddhist, Taoist and Confucius traditions, or the public assemblies of the Germanic people. They all bear testimony to the interpersonal method of conflict resolution throughout most of human history for the entire world's people. The ancient Arab, Greek, and Roman civilizations accepted a restorative approach even for homicide. The period from 11th to 19th century, the emergence of political state and rising of monarchy resulted the king apportioning the power of dispute resolution to himself, prosecuting and punishing the offenders in place of negotiating settlement on behalf of the victim and the society. Slowly and gradually, the interpersonal conflict resolution transformed into third parties conflict resolution by the state. Disillusioned with the conventional criminal justice system, on account of huge pendency of cases, long and persecuting delayed trials, coupled with total exclusion of the victim from the entire criminal justice administration, has witnessed a revival of interest in restorative justice practices across the globe. Restorative justice means that it is an age-old value which is reflecting justice, accountability, and restoration. The believers in restorative justice suggest that restorative justice practices are much more beneficial than traditional punitive approaches in addressing the claims of victims of crime who otherwise invariably are a non-entity and forgotten lot in the entire criminal justice delivery system. Restorative justice strategies like mediation, victim support and advanced advocacy, restitution, compensation, victim offender conferencing, victim empathy, community policing, etc. give opportunities to the offender to make amends, apologize, gain acceptance by willing to repair harm and get reintegrated in the society, unlike the punitive approach of fine, reprimand, punish, incarceration, suspend, expel, which results in labeling the wrongdoers and thereby excluding them from reconciliation. Reintegration involves separating the wrongful act from the actor and disapproving the deed while intrinsically recognizing the worth of human being. This is precisely what Mahatma Gandhi's famous adage says, "Hate the sin, not the sinner," also exhorts. The United Nations Handbook on Restorative Justice Programs specifies underlying assumptions of restorative justice program by highlighting that the response to crime should repair the harm suffered by the victim as much as possible. That offenders should be brought to understand that their behavior is not acceptable and it had some real consequences for the victim and community. That offenders can and should accept responsibility for their action. That victims should have an opportunity to express their needs and to participate in determining the best way for the offender to make reparation. That the community has a responsibility to contribute to the process. And there are primarily three conceptions about restorative justice. The first conception of encounter focuses on the meeting together of parties to discuss the crime, its consequences and what should be done to rectify the situation. And the second reparative conception focuses on the need to repair the harm resulting from crime. Even though this is the best to be done in an encounter process, But even if there is the encounter process and it is not, for instance, if the offender is never caught or the victim is unwilling to participate, still the harm has to be repaired. And lastly, the transformative conception is the broadest perspective, as it not only embraces encounter and reparation, but also focuses on the structural and individual injustices. For instance, it draws attention to the structural injustice by identifying and attempting to resolve underlying causes of crime, such as poverty or idleness. Retributive criminal justice system and restorative justice criminal system can be distinguished on the basis of the following features. The retributive system defines crime as violation of law, focusing on establishing guilt, stigmatizing the culprit, where victim is largely ignored. But in contrast, if we talk about restorative justice system, offense is defined as harm to a person, to a community, focuses on solving problems, taking into consideration victim's rights and needs, and the stigma of culprit is largely removable. These distinguishing parameters of the two criminal justice systems clearly highlight the attitudinal difference in dealing with wrongdoers. This is bound to affect the recipient wrongdoer and the society, not only in letting people reintegrate into the mainstream, but be a constructive resource to the community. Of late, the value of restorative practices is being realized to in various other fields of human activity, as education, parenting, counseling, community organizations, leadership, management, and motivation of human beings, and the need of social disciplining in ensuring cohesive coexistence. Of late, the value of restorative practices is being realized in various other fields of human activity, example, education, parenting, counseling, organizational leadership involving management and motivation of human beings, and the need of social disciplining for ensuring cohesive coexistence. There can be a vast range of restorative justice practices, from being most informal to being formal, structured, and more impactful. Some of these are victim-offender conferences in criminal justice context, others disciplinary problem-solving policy initiatives in dispute between citizens, conflict resolution workshops in organizational context, team building sessions, occupational settings, marital advice and counseling services, parental guidance and admonishment of their misbehaving children, apologizing for offenses or otherwise hurtful remarks in institutional and other settings. Restorative approaches across cultures reflect that restorative approach to criminal justice administration is in practice across the globe. Many cultures have informally embedded some aspects of restorative justice in the dispute resolution mechanisms. For instance, informal participation in sentencing procedures has been a way of Australian and Canadian indigenous people's way of life for decades. This practice is largely informal and community-based. Some of the countries adopted and modified the approach to suit their unique justice dispensation systems. Over the years, strategies like victim-offender mediation, community-family group conferencing, peacemaking committees, sentencing circles have already been recognized as time-tested processes, furthering restoration perspectives. Talking about New Zealand, there is what it is called community and family group conferencing model, adopted into national legislation and applied to the youth justice process in New Zealand starting from 1989. The majority of cases are handled by the police through a restorative caution. By police-directed court family group conferencing or police diversion schemes, it is based on the dispute resolution tradition of the Maori. Each conferencing process has a convener or a facilitator. It brings together the family and friends of both the victim and the offender, and sometimes also other members of the community, to participate in the professionally facilitated process. Desirable outcomes for the parties are usually identified and efforts are made to address the consequences of the crime. Then, appropriate ways to prevent the offending behavior from reoccurring are explored. Because of its effectiveness, this model is now widely used in modified forms in several other states as well. Model, the police used their personnel to run conferences of offenders, victims and community members to resolve feelings and needs after a crime incident. Having turned out a success, police in other states observed and replicated same in their respective states. Later on, conferencing got spread to schools and workplaces in New South Wales and Queensland too. At present in Australia, different agencies are responsible for restorative justice in different states. Reportedly, the entire 8 states and territories have used the conference model. In Canada, US and Czech Republic, it was in the year 1974 that the first recorded victim offender mediation and reparation service in recent times in the Western Hemisphere took place in Ontario, Canada. Around this time, Canada developed the well-known Mennonite Initiative. Since that date, restorative justice programs have grown steadily, including small and large schemes. Participants in this restorative approach are assisted to understand why they behave the way they behave and why do they behave, and provided problem-solving skills that strengthens them as they learn to independently fix their mistakes, repair relationships and return to balance. It is a well-known fact that self-discipline results in improved self-esteem, healthier relationships and increased achievement. Talking about United Kingdom, in England and Wales, there are the youth offender panels that are operational and it is based on a referral order. How does it work? First-time and young offenders between the age of 10 and 17 are referred to youth offender panels. The panels are attended by young persons and a parent or guardian, the victim, if any, and a person who may have an influence on the young person may also be invited. The panel decides on an action plan through which the young persons can make reparation and address his or her problems. The victim may be invited to meet the offender or to express his or her feelings about the offense and consider what form of reparation should take. But the decision remains with the court. On the same lines, indigenous customary laws of so many African countries provide the foundations for building the capacity of the justice system. Here, social responsibility, reconciliation between the offender and the victim, and a sense of justice forms the focal point of the practice. Now, coming to the restorative justice approaches in international law, we find the United Nations with a mandate on protecting and furthering human rights of all peoples across nations, color, gender, creed, ethnicity has in all earnest declared and resolved several documents with an intent to promote a dignified and empowered global community. Towards this end of restoring human relations on international plane against the backdrop of World War II, Beijing rules for the treatment of prisoners, whether of war or domestic, were adopted in 1955. The 1985 Declaration on Juvenile on Justice to Victims of Crime and Abuse of Power, referring to United Nations Congress on the Prevention of Crime and the Treatment of Offenders, recognized two kinds of victims, which are victims of crime and victims of abuse of power. This UN declaration has identified 4 major entitlements as needs of the victim, namely, first, access to justice and fair treatment This includes access to the mechanism of justice and prompt redressal, a right to be informed of the victim's right, a right to proper assistance through the legal process, and a right to protection of privacy and safety. Second, restitution. This includes return of property or payment for the harm or loss suffered where public official or other agents have violated criminal laws. The victim should restitute and receive restitution from the state. As far as compensation is concerned, when compensation is not fully available from the offender or when it results in bodily injury, for while national funds should be established. As far as assistance is concerned, victim should receive the necessary material, medical, psychological and social assistance through governmental or voluntary community-based means. Police, justice, health and social service personnel should receive training in this regard. The 1985 declaration was followed by the 10th UN Congress on the Prevention of Crime and Treatment of Offenders. The Vienna Declaration on Crime and Justice 2000 that advocated the development of restorative justice policies, procedures and programs that are respectful of the rights, needs and interests of victims, offenders, communities and all of the parties. In August 2002, the United Nations Economic and Social Council adopted a resolution calling upon member states implementing your restorative justice programs to draw on a set of basic principles on the use of restorative justice programs in criminal matters. In 2005, the declaration of the 11th UN Congress on the Prevention of Crime and the Treatment of Offenders urged the member states to recognize the importance of further resolving and developing restorative justice policies, procedures and programs that include alternatives to prosecution. These efforts of the UN clearly show that the international community realizes the significance of interpersonal restorative strategies and is moving in the direction of having a well-entrenched legal framework for the same. This is so because restorative justice programs can be used to reduce the burden on the criminal justice system or divert cases out of the system and provide the system with a range of constructive sanctions both nationally and internationally. The Indian experience reveals that our history and culture is full of illustrations reflecting compassion, pity, forgiveness, etc. in dispute resolution mechanisms. Our indigenous system was primarily based on restorative approach until the Britishers established their empire and took the control of criminal justice in their hands. On the basis of adversarial approach to protect their own colonial interests. Even today, the aboriginal tribes and tribals in remote and interior areas resolve their conflicts through conciliation. And the surrender and rehabilitation of dacoits from Chambal Valley by Vinoba Bhave and Jayaprakash Narayan are illustrative of restorative practices in Indian scenario. 20th century India has witnessed huge changes of far-reaching implications with reference to criminal justice administration. The Criminal Procedure Code 1973 is a comprehensive code laying down elaborate procedures for criminal justice dispensation. There are express legislative provisions that reflect a restorative justice orientation. The Criminal Procedure Code in Section 320 CRPC permits compounding, which means mutual settlement and reconciliation of some offences between parties themselves or with the permission of the court under subsection 1 and 2 respectively, and leaves quite a few where compounding is not permissible. Section 320 subclause 8 declares that compounding of offence amounts to acquittal. Even in cases where technically compounding is not permissible, but parties have reached a settlement, the Supreme Court has impliedly allowed the compounding by a careful and curious strategy of recognizing the inherent power under Section 482 CRPC to secure the ends of justice. Supreme Court in Gyan Singh's case 2012 clearly shifted from formal justice to real justice and from adversarial to restitutive approach, shedding away legalism. Also, Chapter 21A of CRPC deals with the concept and procedure of plea bargaining, inserted by an amendment in 2006. Plea bargaining is the acceptance of guilt by the accused in lieu of lesser charge or punishment being pressed by the prosecution before the court. It may involve an agreement to pay compensation too. Section 265A to 265L prescribes that a plea bargaining application can be made by an accused only in those cases where the offence doesn't have punishment of more than 7 years, doesn't affect the socio-economic condition of country, that is, neither committed against a woman or a child below the age of 14 years. Public prosecutor, the complainant, the accused, and the police officer who investigated the case are all allowed to reach a mutually satisfactory disposition without any influence and shall report the outcome to the court. However, the court is duty bound to ensure that the proceedings for arriving at mutually satisfactory disposition are completely voluntary by the parties. All this clearly highlights the shifting focus towards informal and mutually beneficial mediation and conciliation, ensuring victim empowerment and reducing recidivism. This has a ripple effect in increased acceptance by making the accused realize his fault and irrational wrongful conduct, generating compassion and empathy for the victim. Another set of express provisions in CRPC deals with compensation. Social justice demands equal compensation in a welfare state. Section 357 CRPC provides for payment of compensation out of fine imposed on the accused, if any. Even in cases where no fine is imposed, it empowers the court to order the accused person to pay such compensation as may be prescribed to the victim who has suffered any loss or injury due to the conduct of the accused, for which he has been tried and sentenced. The 1985 Declaration on the Rights of Victims of Crime and Abuse of Power, the Vienna Declaration on Crime and Justice 2000, the Declaration on Prevention of Crime and the Treatment of Offenders 2005, coupled with Malimut Committee Report 2003, made the perfect backdrop for the provision of a victim compensation scheme through the amendment of CRPC in 2009. The contours of Section 357A have been broadened to include all victims, irrespective of the fact that the accused could not be identified and no trial has taken place. The idea of compensation is relevant for the victim of crime and abuse of power also. Hence, Section 358 addresses this concern too by recognizing the claim to seek compensation of people who are groundlessly arrested. Also, Section 360 CRPC deals with probation. It provides for release of a person on probation of good conduct or after admonition. Even this section reflects a restorative approach with reference to a first-time offender and lays down the specific and subjective circumstances of the offender with age, character, and antecedents of the offender to be considered for releasing him on probation. Also, the Probation of Offenders Act 1958 visualizes under Section 3, release of offenders after admonition, Section 4, release on probation, Section 5, ordering compensation for loss or injury caused by the act to be paid by the offender, Section 6, dealing with youthful offenders under Section 21, under 21 years of age, having indulged in offense for which the imprisonment but life may not be imposed is dealt with under Section 3, 4 and not to be sentenced. The Legal Services Authority Act 1987 has also introduced the Lok Adalats, which are people's court, in order to reduce the pendency of cases. Section 24 provides that Lok Adalats are considered to arrive at a compromise or for settlement of disputes and resolving the disputes, and such a compromise cuts neither the challenge nor appeals against in higher judiciary by virtue of an amendment in 2002. The Lok Adalats have jurisdiction to decide any matter, thus through the very focus on compromise and settlement in these people's court, a restorative approach has been given recognition in the formal dispute resolution mechanism in a robust manner. We also have community service as a form of punishment, which has been lately used by a number of high courts to deliver real justice, even though it's not expressly included in the CRPC. Though a part of Juvenile Justice 2015 Act, it has unfortunately not been included despite recommendation of the Law Commission of India and Malimit Committee in their respective reports. Over and above these legislative measures, even the Indian judiciary has steadfastly moved in recognizing rights of not only the accused but increasingly victims too. Landmark cases from Rudal Shah in 1983 to Neelavati 1993 to the recent Ankush Gaikwad case have all been instances and milestones in recognizing victims' rights. Towards the forward-looking ways, we can understand that crime and punishment are two supplementary and complementary aspects of any given human society. For a cohesive coexistence, we need to have disciplining measures and mechanisms in place. Law is but one such instrument of regulation with the ever-changing conception about criminality and its causes. Law needs to keep pace with such developments and thoughts about development. Law must be dynamic in the approach towards addressing the issues of interpersonal conflicts. This is in conformity with the utilitarian philosophy of punishment, requiring maximization of the sum total of happiness of the entire group. Adopting restorative approach would be the most apt way of dealing with the cause and effect of crime. Owing to the flexibility and adaptability, keeping in mind varying socio-centric factors for the incidence of crime, we need to have a comprehensive restorative justice act, incorporating the basic principles, substances and procedures of restorative justice. It should empower the law enforcement agencies, individuals and the courts to prioritize it as an alternative dispute redressal mechanism in all criminal matters mandatorily, especially with reference to juveniles, mentally challenged offenders and women. Other heinous offenses with stringent punishment like murder, dacoity, sexual offenses, terrorism related activities would certainly require an indulgent exercise of discretion to figure out the feasibility of restorative justice processes by the appropriate authorities, and the statute should be made applicable to the whole of India. In the meanwhile, it is incumbent upon various state agencies, the government, to effectively implement victim compensation scheme with substantial corpus, the police, prison and judicial officers to be duly trained to make them understand the philosophy underlying and the significance of utilizing alternative strategies while dealing with conflict situations. An alternative way forward is for the legislature to minimally bring about an amendment in the CRPC and expressly incorporate restorative justice approach. By so doing, the judiciary, police and other stakeholders seized with such situations of interpersonal conflict will be empowered to swiftly and authoritatively act in dispute resolutions. Armed with such statutory powers, they will be able to adopt restorative justice approach rather than the current and counterproductive adversarial and retributive approaches. Restorative justice is result-oriented. Thank you very much for watching this video.